So my name is Vladislav. I am from University of Auckland. I'm a senior lecturer at the Department of Mechanical and Electronic Engineering. And I will be talking about wave pattern and periodic, quasi-periodic and graded structure. So, first of all, I obviously want to thank organizers of this program for inviting me. Also, maybe participating in the last workshop, which is on engineering and practical education, be more relevant for me because I'm an engineer. But I have some issues with my ego because I'm Russian. So basically, these 2 weeks is one of the time when I can come. Okay? Here. So, as I understood from the description for this workshop, basically here the focus should be on maybe presenting some approach and methods for solving problems in wave cutting, and maybe less focus on this would be on some particular problems, particular phenomena, and particular applications, So basically, I decided to put my talk will be on basically presenting one method, which is from completely different field, which is originally developed for analyzing parametrically excited systems, and then just show how this method can actually actually work to analyze wave propagation in periodic structures. Yes, not only periodic structures, quasi-periodic structures, nonlinear structures, and so on. So I will start with some background on situation, discussing basically what is the parameter of static system, what is the parameter of dissipation. Then I will present briefly to them this method, it's called method of Orion entities. Then I will talk how we apply this method for periodic structures. Then I will talk about quasi-periodic structures and interesting phenomena for this structure. Then I will talk about 2D wave types like plates. And then, I'm not sure what I will have time, but maybe we'll talk about graded materials and approach that can be used for these materials. Okay, and then finally, some conclusions. Okay, so what is parameter dissipation? This is something exotic. No, it's not exotic. And parameter dissipation for a given system, it just means that okay, you have a system, and then you just write the question, and you see that certain parameter for your system varies with time. It just changes. So it means that your system is parametrically excited. And the classical example is just a pendulum with vibrating support. So it's a pendulum, and its support is going up and down. So it has the gravity. It changes with time, and basically it has parametric excitation. Another example is a beam. So let's say that we have a beam that performs flexural vibrations in the vertical direction. So if we excite the beam vertically, then obviously this will be direct excitation. If we excite horizontally, it will be parametric excitation. Okay. And then finally, if we talk about periodic structures, then obviously certain parameters are changing with not time, but with space. And basically, it means that we have parametric excitation, but now not in the space of time, but with space. It's a specific structural time. Okay, why is it interesting? Because we get, why is this parameter dissipation interesting? It's interesting because we can get very interesting phenomena. We can get phenomena which is actually kind of useful for application. So, the classical phenomena that actually trapped me into science is this one. So, this is a phenomena that if you have a pendulum, inverted pendulum, you start to take it up and down, the axis of extension up and down. And then this upper position becomes stable. So basically, if you go to the Department of Engineering here, this is what we also saw experimentally to this. And then my PhD was on something relevant, so it was basically something related. It was related to what we're trying to do, we're trying to control motions of some inclusion, like gas bubbles and fluid. And basically, we get very interesting phenomenon where gas bubbles can actually sink. If you apply hyperemic vibrations to your examples of water, then bubbles in this water, as you saw from previous to the start of the sink. And there's some paper in nature on this. Okay. And then if we talk about periodic structures, then obviously the most important phenomenon is the presence of frequency bandgaps. So the frequency bandgaps are amazing because they can provide a simulation over wind elastic waves in our sensors. So we'll look at the potential practical applications and existing practical applications for this frequency bandgap. Okay? So if we talk about existing methods, not existing, but conventional methods for analyzing parameter precision or parameter precision systems, then obviously we need to mention the classical methods. So the first method is the method of harmonic balance, so basically computer series solutions for these parameter precision systems. And then we can also mention asymptotic methods, like multiple scales methods, the method of averaging, and so on. So these are trivial methods. I'm a big fan of this method. They can give us periodic computer series solutions. But unfortunately, they work only if linearity is weak, or maybe if the parameter precipitation is weak. So there are some restrictions, and then we can use this method. Okay? And then finally, our favorite method from Floquet theory, based on Floquet theory, so basically they work very nicely, but they work only for linear periodic systems. So the system has to be linear and periodic. But in applications, and then from engineering, we need very actually required methods that can potentially be applied for a wider range of problems. So let's say that we have a system with multiple parameters. So different frequencies, everything is not related. The frequencies are not related. You cannot use this method. And also maybe the system is stronger than the other. And also we basically want to try to capture solutions in a border. Like we want to maybe have a method that can provide a broader range of solutions, including non-periodic and so on. So and there is a method that actually was proposed recently. So the method is called mass of varying amplitudes that basically seems to be working. And again, this is a method which is called the engineering method. We like it because it works. For some particular problems, it works simply working method. Okay. So this is the most difficult part of the topic. The most mathematical part. So just presenting this method, the main idea of this method. So let's say that we have some, as a simple example, let's say that we have some ordinary differential equation with respect to some vector x, which is a function of time. Okay? And then this ordinary differential equation involves basically parameter and characterization with a lot of different frequencies. Okay, so we don't have time like this. So this is complicated, this is difficult. And I really don't like things that are difficult. So what I'm going to do, what we want to do, we want to reformulate this complicated equation into something much more simple. So we just reformulate this equation into some form that will not involve this kind of physicality. Okay? So what do? We just use this simple solution form. So basically, just harmonic series, but with amplitudes which are time-dependent. And we don't want put any restrictions on the amplitude, so everything is very simple. So then we just put this solution form into our equation, original equation, powerful harmonic, the same as the harmonic balance method. And then we get new equation, new system of equations. Okay? So we basically, what we have done, we just reformulated the original equation with respect to this new variable B. And by contrast to the harmonic balance method, there are no opportunities. Because basically, we don't put any restrictions on this variable. Okay. And if we consider the system is periodic, if our original system is periodic, then everything is amazing. Because these new equations, they are autonomous. So these are autonomous equations with constant frequencies, and they are much more easy to solve than original equations. And for linear periodic systems, basically, our method is very similar to conventional equations based on Floquet theory. So you will get exactly the same result as if you have used the conventional plane wave expansion method. Exactly the same thing, I will show it. Okay, but what if the system is not periodic? Then unfortunately, the same equations are not autonomous, and they involve, again, some parameters and direct excitations with different frequencies, but the number of incremental frequencies, so the frequencies that do not have common drivers, in this new equation is reduced by one comparing to the original system. So this is still maybe not what we want, but it's better than the original equation. So we just apply again our method, and then we just apply it again and again and again until we get equations that do not involve any physics. And so finally, basically, we get our original equation transformed into a system in a nice system of autonomous equations with constant gain. So everything is straightforward. And this system is very easy to test. Okay? So just, I needed to, since I am originally I'm from nonlinear dynamics, when I needed to solve this slide, just to briefly show that it is, even if we consider very simple system, so this is just conventional matrix equation, and matrix equation is like a classical example of parameter such a system. So we basically have some time dependency over the system, as you see. And we just add a bit of nonlinearity here. So what will happen if we use conventional perturbation methods, if we use conventional synthetic methods, and I'm a big fan of these methods, because I like methods, they're a nice idea, and I suggest the calculator is good. Then what we will get this black line. We get this black line and this dotted line. So dotted line is unstable, black line is stable, okay? And we also get some zero solution. Now if we want to integrate this equation numerically, directly solve it, then we get all these dots, black dots, okay? Black dots, boom, 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 and then it drops. So, okay, our multiple cells method works very nicely here, but here we start to get some deviations. So maybe we just need to use the second approximation. We need to use the second approximation of this method, and if we do it, there are two options for the grid. Then we get the green line or the red line, and this is still not far away from what is actually happening. So now let's just use this method of varying amplitude, no problem. Second order approximation, and we get this blue line. So we sort of perfectly matching, we're perfectly matching the numerical solution. And actually, we're engineers, so what the main aim of us for us here for this problem was just to predict the maximum response. So the frequency, and the variance value of the amplitude, and we're actually using this method of varying amplitude, we can get exclusive analytical expressions for this frequency and amplitude. Okay? So basically, I'm a big fan of multiple scales method and the averaging method, but sometimes we need to use maybe this method. Method of varying amplitude. Okay, so now let's talk about periodic structures. So if we talk about periodic structures, then, of course, the parameters vary not with time, but with space. And we have parameterization with respect to temperature variation. Okay? So why we like periodic structures? Because we have the frequency bandgaps. And then basically, they are amazing. Because in the frequency bandgaps, we can get a combination of waves traveling in the structure. And this is amazing. So there are two mechanisms for these bandgaps in periodic structures, physical mechanisms. And always when you're talking about physics, behind everything that is happening in the real system. So the first one is Bragg scattering, which is related to multiple wave scattering, essentially. And the second is local resonance, then basically we just have local resonance of this resonator attached to the structure. If we don't have resonators, so we have just the same masses attached to the structure, then we don't get the second bandgap. The second type of bandgap. Obviously, I will be focusing on Bragg scattering in this talk because this workshop is about multiple wave scattering. So I will just try to show how using this method of varying amplitude we can predict bandgaps in this Bragg scattering for time periodic systems. Okay, so the first example is relatively simple. So let's start with something like conventional and straightforward. So let's say that we have a layer, just a layer. And we consider a longitudinal wave motion in this layer. But this layer has some periodic variation of thickness. And this periodic variation can be anything. It can be T plus constant, T plus linear, it can be harmonic, anything. We don't care. What we want to understand how our, what, and actually what, not only understand, but get an analytical expression for the bandgap. So why for the bandgap and what is this for the bandgap? So each of these. So how do we do it? We use the method of varying amplitude. So first we just assume that, as usual, we assume that everything is harmonic with time, so the floating harmonic with time, then we get this, and then we always try to scale everything to get non-dimensional equations, then we get this equation. Relatively simple, and this is our thickness variation. variation. So basically, since we basically consider some arbitrary variations here, then we have all these different harmonics in our signal strain. Okay. And then we just use the method of running amplitude. So we just take this, this solution, insert it into the equation, balance the harmonics, and then we get a final set of coupled autonomous equations for these new functions. And they are linear and autonomous. So they are super nice to solve. So the solution for this linear autonomous equations are obviously just some constant vector multiplied by the exponent of the hidden value multiplied by the height. And this kappa is just the root of the periodicity equation of the system. So this is super easy. Basically, one step, and we are already obtaining a very simple solution to this problem. And obviously, if we actually write down the solution, then it just looks like this. So this is exactly what you should have done if you use the plain weighted function method or other methods based on like FP. Okay? So we just have some periodic function F, which is actually, you can weigh all these amplitudes in this here, and then we have our weight number. It's calculated with both weight number and the frequency. Okay? So everything is super simple, but we want to get analytical expressions for the bandgaps. And using this method, we can do it. We just use expansion in a small parameter, and then we can get very simple expression for the white, to predict the white of all the bandgaps for different perturbation states. So this is how it looks like. So the white of, let's say, all the, for each of the old bandgaps, the white is just this. Okay? And the speed of this old bandgap is just this one. So very simple expression. So essentially, we can say that each particular old bandgap is governed only by one harmonic. Okay? And then for the even bandgaps, we get something much more complicated, but it's not a problem. We are not still at this point. Okay? So this is a very simple problem. And we basically, as an engineer, as a designer, if you want to design a structure that will provide the attenuation in the DNA area, it's very nice to have all these cluster instructions because you just use them and you design a structure. So it's not numerical, it's analytical. Okay, also we have done, this method can be, since I'm from linear dynamics, of course, I want to use this method for linear problems. So straightforward, we can use, we can try to study ethics of linearity on the truth of the bandgap for periodic structures, and some research has been done in this paper. We can also study systems that vary both in time and space, basically as removing periodic structures. And this has been also done, but basically the main focus of this talk is on quasi-periodic. So what are the, can we predict, if can we actually consider quasi-periodic structures and try to predict bandgaps for quasi-periodic structures? Maybe there are no bandgaps at all. So again, this was motivated by some engineering question, practical application. So the question was, okay, this all this periodic structures are really nice and beautiful, but maybe we can do something better. Maybe if we have maybe a more complicated structure, let's say quasi-periodic structure, something like this. Maybe it will have a nice, a better performance in terms of vibration attenuation. Okay? So basically, we have this market on modulation with special periods, and if we talk about true quasi-periodic structure, then the special periods must be incrementally. So they must not have any common device. Okay? So this is what we try to do. And essentially it means that we have parameter representations with multiple different periods. Okay? So we just write, we start with a simple problem, a linear layer. So this is the Gatling equation. We have stiffness and mass properties underlying the special Gatling equation. So for few periodic structures, we get something like this, exactly the same as in the previous problem. So quasi-periodic structure will get something like this. So we have all these additional modulations here. Okay? And we don't put any restrictions on the special periods of these additional modulations. They can be anything. It doesn't matter. Okay? So when, again, as always, we scale everything down, we want to get non-dimensional equations, and then we get this equation. And since we are obviously engineers and we're lazy, we just want to get principal effects. We just want to get principal insight into ethics of this quasi-periodicity. We consider a simple case when we just have two harmonics with different non-related periods. So this is what we do, and when we just start to apply our methods, see? So we just use the solution procedure, this varying amplitude, insert into the governing equation, balance with harmonics, and then we get this equation. We get a system of equations. Maybe it looks scary because 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 lines, that still can be written explicitly, okay? It's still not really good because we have all these parameter resistations here, but we can just apply the method again. So we just do it, and then we get this equation. Okay, 6 lines, but these equations are really nice because these equations are linear autonomous equations. Linear coupled autonomous equations. Okay? So super easy to solve, and the solution is just this one. So it's just basically some matrix of the amplitudes multiplied by this exponent factor. So the same as in the previous case, but instead of vector, we have a matrix. Okay? And then the beauty is that we can actually determine all these components of this matrix and also this unknown opportunity just from by solving this equation. But here on the right hand side we have 0, D is one known matrix, and we know we have explicit expressions to all these components for this matrix, and they're just like this. Okay, so we have explicit analytical expressions, so there is no problem to solve it. Okay, so if we come back to the original problem and we try to write down the solution, then it just looks like this. So it's actually exactly the same form as for the view periodic structure, right? Exactly the same thing. But now the function f is not periodic, but quasi-periodic. And actually, in which all these amplitudes to be. Okay? But this is not a problem. It's actually more or less expected result. Okay, so if our modulations are small, epsilon is small, then we can just, because this matrix unfortunately is four-dimensional, then we can make things simple, we can truncate the solution series, and then we can actually write down everything in the conventional two-dimensional form, and basically just reduce the problem to solving just one equation. Just one equation, basically similar to the previous case. Okay. So basically all we do, we just truncate the solution series, and then we just reduce our four-dimensional matrix into two-dimensional one, and then we just try to find the determinant of the two-dimensional matrix. We can do it numerically, but again, we like equations, so we do it analytically. Again, the idea is trying to obtain analytical expressions for these closed form expressions for the bandgaps. So can we do it? We just use a small parameter expansion, and again, a big fan of all these perturbation methods. And just getting sometimes upset if they don't work, and then I need to use other methods. But here we just use this small parameter expansion, and then basically we get 2 critical frequencies, this one and this one, at which we will probably have the, from which our bandgaps will grow. And then we can get simple expressions for the width of each of the bandgaps. Okay. So the nice example, the nice result, and basically as engineers, we always like simple results, which are simple to use, let's say if you want to design something. The nice result is that if we consider this quasi-periodic structure, when the lowest band gap, it uses the modulations for different periods, they are actually not affected by each other. So this one only depends on the first modulation, this one only on the second. And this is nice. Okay? But this is correct only if delta, so the difference between the modulation periods is not small. So what will happen if it's actually small, then the things start to get really tricky. So we try to do this expansion again, and then basically it's better to present it on a figure. And so we use this expansion for factor 0, epsilon factor 1, epsilon squared factor 2, and then basically our omega frequency is just one half because this is the physical frequency from which I can go, plus epsilon sigma. Okay, so we just throw sigma with frequency with respect to wave number, and basically if our kappa 1 is real, we have propagating wave. If kappa 1 is complex, then we have bandgap. So basically, the red line corresponds to the real value, and then this blue and green line represent real and imaginary parts of the complex kappa 1. Okay? So basically, we clearly have the bandgaps, okay? But we also have something interesting. We have some additional bandgaps, smaller bandgaps, and if we plot the imaginary part of kappa 1, respect to the frequency, then this is what we get. So here this red line shows the band gap only for the structure with only one modulation, and then this green for the structure with only with one modulation. So two quasi-periodic structures considered separately, one with one modulation, another with another modulation. The first one will give us red band gap, the second one will give us green band gap. If we combine them together, with modulations in one structure, then we get this thing. So definitely we have some interaction between the bandgaps. And if we start to reduce the difference between the modulation periods, then we start to get something interesting. And then we do it again, and then we start to essentially, basically, if we reduce it, reduce it, reduce it, then all these modulations, all these different bandgaps, then we form one noise bandgap. So some of this. So again, here basically the blue line is the bandgap that we get for this quasi-periodic structure. This red line is the bandgap if you have only one modulation. Green line if you have only the second modulation. This purple line is basically when you just add the amplitude of the modulations together and try to get the bandgap. And this black line is when you just basically use the square root. So you just use square root and square plus n is d square. Okay? So we get actually really interesting interaction between the bandgaps. If modulations are close to each other, if periods of modulations are close to each other, this is interesting. And okay, so now if we consider the if we want to validate this result, then we just basically solve directly. We can do it in two ways. We can just directly solve the equation for that we have obtained, the determinant A equal to zero, or we can just directly solve the original equation of motion. So if you directly solve the original equation of motion, you get this bandgap formed by the shaded region here. So this is the first bandgap, second bandgap, and then also some bandgap higher. And then if you just directly solve the determinant, you just get this, all this black, so basically, the obvious observation here is that we consider the quasi-periodic structures as if you get more predictive bandgaps than two periodic structures combined. This is interesting. And then also, basically, we have done some validation of this interesting device for the, when the set is small, then delta is small for them. So again, so here, this shaded region is the direct numerical integration, the bandgap that we obtain by direct numerical integration. Yes, so we again we confirm what we get with one north bandgap, but what is interesting, and this was actually possible to obtain only numerically, that on the boundary between the bandgap forming the north one, so with green lines, actually the attenuation tends to be zero. So we have something really interesting here. But as an engineer, I was thinking that this is not super important. What is important is that we can get more band gaps, and we can actually predict the allocation. And then also, if we have even non-small modulations, and we have non-small values of difference between the periods of modulation, then each of the two restricted band gaps is governed only by one of modulations. And this is nice, because it helps to design the structure. See? So then, also, obviously, in this paper, very important part was on low frequency band gaps, because as an engineer, we always want to suppress the equations at low frequency. But I don't want to discuss it here because it's related to practical applications and not mathematics. Okay, so now if we talk about the 2D structure. So let's consider something a bit more difficult. So let's say that we have a piece of plate. We have done it also for medium plate, so I really like medium here. It works. Because it works experimentally. So medium, here we use people, and we just consider that the first time variation of the thickness. Okay? So thickness variation with respect to two different coordinates, and here this D is a bending radiity that depends on the thickness, so it also depends on these two coordinates. And if we consider periodic case, then everything is super simple. So each of these functions, then you can use the thickness, you can just use two-dimensional Floquet series expansion, and just again represent everything in the form of this different commands, those different entities. This is our parameter to the system that we will input into the system. Okay, simple query is everything is quadratic, so we have quadratic cells. And basically, everything is simple. We just need to use non-dimensional things to just introduce the non-dimensional frequency. And then we get this non-dimensional equation. And here, basically, all these functions S, A, and G also, they involve the sines and cosines. So they involve the parameter of the equation. So basically, we have a system that parameters the equation with the X and Y. And now we just want to see what will happen in terms of the radiation. No problem, we just use the method of our emphasis, use our system, and then, okay, since we have variations with respect to each and y, then we need to do, okay, harmonic series with respect to x, then harmonic series with respect to I, to y, and in this case, our amplitudes are functions not only of x, but also of y, and then if we, in the end, basically, if we use this, insert into the additional equation, then we get a final set of linear coupled vectors, so this new variable. So exactly the same as before. We get always, we always get the linear coupled vector multiplication. Okay? And the solution is exactly the same as before, but we just now have this matrix G multiplied not only by exponent couplings, but also exponent couplings. Okay? But we again get linear algebraic equations for determining couplings of Y and this amplitude. And we can very easily obtain this possible relationship to this. So what is interesting is that essentially we just use exactly the same procedure as for the quasi-periodic equation. There is no, from a macro point of view, there is no difference. We eventually just need to solve, reduce everything to solve one equation, determinant, and actually it will be zero. This is super easy, and then just example result. So this is for quadratic cell. So here the results are shown for irreducible Turing zone, so gamma is n. And basically, what we get is what we get, okay, we get that there is some critical range shown in this red line, sorry, in this red region, in which we have, so to say, complete bandgap. So it doesn't matter what direction of our wave propagation, we get this complete bandgap. And this is nice. This is nice because we can actually use this bandgap potentially to do something useful for transport efficiency. So the question, can we use this frequency bandgap to increase sound transmission depth of the wall panel? Okay. So let's say that we have a wall and it actually transmits some sound, but we don't want it to transmit sound. Maybe we can induce some kind of periodicity into the wall, and then we get bandgap, and maybe due to the fact that due to the bandgap, we will say we will suppress a lot of transmission. And especially we are talking about a particular region, which is called the tensing region. So this tensing region, frequency region, in this particular frequency region, we get a very strong coupling between the sound and bending waves in our plate. Okay? So why this is happening? Because the sound will be equal to the wave in this, to the bending waves in this plane. So they couple. Okay? So let's see, maybe it will work. So that's why we started to do all this nonsense with mathematics, because we wanted to basically describe this standard like this structure. So we want to have a structure with surface pattern variations, because these are nice. We don't introduce any additional masses to the structure. We just do some rooted stuff, and then we can get this finger. We can predict the example analytically using our method. Okay, so this is actually large scale testing, so this is 1 meter, this is 2.2 meters, and we can do all this experimentation in our nice acoustic laboratory, if I can. And then basically the first question, can we just have a nice relation between the bandgap and the increase in the transmission loss through this panel? So you can do it just using some conventional methods, it's called quasi-periodic method. So we just take one periodic cell, and then we include the fluid loading into this method, and then we can actually estimate the transmission loss under these two conditions, or it doesn't matter, we can also use the uplift sound transmission, we can also calculate uplift sound transmission, But what we actually get is that indeed we get this some increase in the frequency range that we want. We get some increase in transmission loss, and it actually aligns with the projection of the bandgap. Okay, so if we talk about experiments, then these are the experimental results. So we have tried many different things, many different propagation fluids. And this black line is the uniform panel. And then all these different lines, colors, they correspond to different states, to different periodic states. And basically, we get that this triangular one, this one, is maybe the best. We get the increase in the transmission loss of around 15 dB, which is a lot, which is incredible. And then basically, this is expected because this triangle pattern is super nice. Super nice, this was 10 before. Okay, so if I have only 4 minutes, then I will not talk about the gradient of material. So I will just go to conclusions. So basically, we will present an approach for studying wave propagation in periodic and quasi-periodic structures. Basically, we consider them just as involving multiple propagations with respect to all the structural coordinates. And then we can explain the second relation of the bandgaps. And potentially, all this can be used for transport. Okay? Thank you very much for your attention.